Today we're in chapter one of the book of Job. I want to start by asking Sarah several questions just to get you thinking together. One is, every morning we get up, and this morning you got up and you had an idea about what you wanted this day to look like. What do you have on your plans for the day? Plain blinds? You have interesting Sundays. I try to avoid that on Sunday if I could. What's on your list to do today?
Cowboy.
So some of you want to be disappointed. Is that what you're doing? I want you to think about that for a moment, because we're going to go through this class and find out that not everything works out that way. So there are some things to stick in your mind. What things stick in your mind? Things you remember.
Usually the days that were off.
Okay. We usually remember that terrible time, don't we? We tend not to remember. Do you remember that day when the sun was shining? I felt really good that day. We usually go, that day I didn't go to the doctor. It was terrible. Yeah, I don't know what the time said, but I do want to think about this for just a moment. I'm going to give you 2 days. Probably everybody in this room knows at least one. Most people know two. When I give you the date, you'll know what happened, but I'm asking you a different question. I'm not asking what happened on that day. I want to ask you what the day started like. First day, November 22nd, 1963. We know what the day ended. How did it start? What was it like when you got up out of bed that day? What was it like in the meantime? Do you remember?
November 22nd.
I remember where I was in this. I was in third grade. I was on the playground in my elementary school after lunch. And then it all changed. If you don't know that day, that's the day Kennedy assassinated. The world changed in a big way that day. Second day was what we celebrated on Wednesday, 9/11/2001. You know what happened at the end of the day? How did the day start? I said at the old Atlanta Bread Company, making my plan for the day. And then some guy came by and says, the second one got hit. That changed a lot of things. That changed a whole lot of things for us. You see, think about it. We're talking about, if we understand, we remember the results. We don't think about how the day started, because the day it started looks like any ordinary day. Every day that begins looks like every ordinary day. But then it's not. There is something that happens on days that you don't expect to have happen. Yesterday, for instance, we were headed to my daughter's house. They're all sick at their house. Something has COVID. My daughter had to go, we had to do twices at once, so I had to take my grandson to T-ball. My wife and our daughter had to take the granddaughter to volleyball to different places. And so we're about to turn the corner on Jupiter to go to their house, and my wife gets a text. The text was about a friend of ours, one of my elders in my previous church. He had been in the backyard, and apparently he had been stung by a bee and killed it. At 8 o'clock yesterday morning, his wife wrote me about my birthday and didn't mention a thing. By 11 o'clock, he was gone. On any given day, something can happen. And so today, we're talking a single day. What happens in a single day? What can change in a single day? Not necessarily why, but to try to understand where we are. This is the beginning of the book of Job. Job 1:1-5. Listen as I read this, because you're going to need to respond to this question. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. There were those born to him, 7 sons and 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 female donkeys, and very many servants. So that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. His sons used to go and hold the feast in the house of each one on his day, and they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate them, and he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, "It may be that my children have sinned and cursed God in their heart." Thus Job did continually. So, what kind of man do you think Job? Would you describe? God fearing. Okay. Would you like Job? What do you think if you met him?
Yeah.
You trust Job? Would you like him to have part of this church? Yeah. You know, look at those things. And his life is pretty good. He has a spiritual life. It says he was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. Now, what does it mean to be upright? What made Job that way? What does it mean to be blameless? What? Does that mean he never sinned? Anybody never sinned? How can you be blameless and never sin and still sin? What's that?
You're human.
You're human, okay. But how can you be blameless? Okay. It's an interesting word, isn't it? Blameless. It's used in the New Testament for what elders are supposed to be. The Hebrew word to mean calm, peaceful. And the word we would use in place of blame would be integrity. He has a life of calm and peacefulness because he doesn't mind having it be examined. What if they want their life poked into? They lawyer up if you try. And there are some people that say, "I don't care, look at me, I don't care. I have nothing to hide." And Job was that. What do you think made him? Why was he blameless?
He believed in God.
Exactly. Okay. What's that back there?
He believed in God.
He believed in God. He was conscious. There are traits that help us become who we need to be. And Job has apparently set his life on a direction that says, "I want to live a kind of life that if people were to ask me about it, I could tell them what I am, what I do, and what I believe without any fear of them contradicting." We don't know exactly how he got that way, but that's who he is. I like this statement from Oswald Chambers. He says, "When you fear God, you fear nothing else. But if you don't fear God, you fear everything else. Because you're afraid of having your life looked at. Because when you fear God, you do the right things." And so Job was one of these people who feared God, and everything else went well in his life. He had a good family. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Now, what does a family do for a person?
Poverty.
What's that? Poverty. 2 of the 4 portions of the apocalypse. What does it do for a person? Okay, you can kind of do something for the things you can think about. Guide and support. Here are some things that are important. If you don't have family, one of the big issues in society today for people who are older is that they don't have family. I have known people, I've done their funerals, their families have all died, and they're the last ones left. And I wonder how they live that way. They didn't have anybody around. And so he had this family, these kids, and they were joy. It was like he had a material life. Someone has said that this list, if you total it up in today's dollars, just the livestock would be worth $34 million. He's secure. He didn't have to worry about where his next meal was coming from. He didn't have to worry about whether or not he's going to starve to death, or if he gets sick, what's going to take place, or what's going to happen a year from now. He's okay. The wolf's not in his room. And so, if you look at his life in totality, he's healthy. We know that because he later on, he's gone. That's next week, by the way. He's wealthy. Last but not wise, by the way. I know what you mean. He's happy. There are four foundations of happiness: faith, family, friends, and purpose. Those are four foundations of happiness. He has all four. He's a happy man. His life is good. Do you think Job had all of this because he feared God?
No, I don't think he received material blessings because he feared God.
Okay. Then it's not, their two are not connected necessarily. This is going to be the big question of the book of Job. And should he continue to fear God when he has no physical possessions? And the real burning issue of the day, at least for them and for us too, why is it there are people who are so wicked that they seem to have everything they want? I know there's a story. And Richardson's in the Imaging Center has been closed down because the CEO of that imaging center had run the hospital system he ran into bankruptcy. He has a $40 million yacht, two private jets, and yet he treats people like that. How can God allow that to happen? A big question. Our physical circumstances, the reflection of our spiritual circumstances. The popular view, 21st century religion of Christianity today is, the answer is yes. Last night, my wife and I watched the movie Leap of Faith. You ever watch Leap of Faith? You ever go to the movie? You go watch it. Stephen Martin. It's about a fake faith healer. It may not claim you, so. But what he's promising everybody in the movie is, if you'll just trust Jesus, your life will be grand. But he knows it's fake. Today we're being told, if you live for God, God will make you wealthy. God will protect you. God will take care of you. You'll never be sick a day in your life. The question then is, if you get into a situation of poverty or deprivation, does that mean there's something wrong with you? That question gets asked in Job too. And so there are three statements in here I want you to think about for a moment. There was a man. On any given day, there is a person. You, me, somebody else. They may not be known, they may not be named, but there are people, multitudes of people, millions of people. Second, it says in verse 6, now there was a day. We don't know what day it was. We don't know if it was Friday, Monday, or whatever. It was just a day, an average day, like any other day. And it says in verse 13, and there was a day, like any other day. Started off like every other day. Just a day. But something happened on one single day. Suddenly there's this change of scene. I mean, you get to verse 6, and man, it's like making a U-turn all of a sudden going 60 miles an hour. Now there was a day. when the sons of God came to present themselves to the Lord, and Satan came among them. Does it surprise you that somehow Satan shows up in heaven? We built this intricate web that says God is so holy he doesn't allow evil around him. So Satan has been banished. No, not necessarily. According to Job, God knows what Satan's doing all the time. He's not unaware. Satan, the word Satan means adversary, by the way. Anybody's your adversary, you're Satan. Or your Hebrew. And he becomes that. Satan of the time. He comes and he says, the Lord says to him, says, where did you come from? Now, I'm with you, I'm studying about questions. They're going to study this when I'm going to teach it, but I'm going to teach it here at this moment. God knows where you've been. God doesn't ask questions for information. He asks questions for confession. Always. He already knows the answer. It's like the mother says, what have you been doing? The little boy says, now before you talk, don't you lie to me. She already knows the answer. That's what. Satan says, I've been going to and fro on the earth, walking up and down. He said, I've just been meandering back and forth, roaming around like it was. This is a good picture. This is a picture I took last year. I'm taking an afternoon walk. I turn the corner, I'm going downhill, and at the end of the block, this is what I see. And not one. Those are bobcats. I'm not sure they're not better than that. Those are robber cats, by the way. They're bigger than bobs. Go look that one up on And it's just looking around. It's looking for dinner. And I didn't want to be dinner. Now, I wouldn't be dinner because I'm too fat. Got chewed too much on me. He's looking for a cat, a rat, a small dog. I don't know why it's in front. I didn't want to know, so I didn't go pursue it. But I like it what it says in 1 Peter chapter 5, because he agrees with what goes on Job. Your devil, your adversary, listen to your adversary, Satan. The devil prowls around like a roaring lion seeking something to devour. Satan's sitting around saying, who can I mess up today? And the unaware, we have a problem. Then God says to him, have you considered my servant Job? There is none like him on all the earth, a blameless and upright mind, man who fears God and turns away from evil. He is all about Job. Now, he's not challenging, he's pointing out here. Job, maybe that's what God thought of him. Bigger question, what do you think God thinks of you? If you were to put your name where Job's name is, have you considered my servant? Would God say that about you? What's up? God has a great amount of confidence. Job is the one who's going to stick firm. Job is the one who's blameless. Job is the one who keeps himself away from evil. He knows. And then Satan says, well, of course he is. Does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him? Have you not put his little fence and you protect him? And you keep him safe? And so anything that you protect is going to serve you. You get a dog to do anything with enough treats. Quit doing the treats and dog and it's fine. So he says, you put a hedge around him. You bless the work of his hands and his possessions have increased in the land. The reason he's faithful is because he's blessed. That's what Satan says. The reason he is faithful is because he's blessed. The premise is, if he's not blessed, he's not faithful. this whole conversation not about Job. We like to think of Job. We like to think that God's talking about Job. He's talking about why does God do what he does? He said, Job is faithful because you bribed him to have a good life. If you've ever kept grandchildren, they'll wear you out. So you do something to them like this, if you're a grandparent. Now, if you'll settle down, we'll go get ice cream. In other words, we will fill you with more sugar to ramp up the energy level, but it will keep you happy for now. Was he giving him ice cream? Keep him happy? He said it's his faith is built on two things. Our question today and throughout this chain lesson is going to come down to this idea. Why do you and I fear God? Is it because of what we get out of it? Now think about how we talk. Let's start with the Thanksgiving prayer. Thank you, Lord, for all these things you have given us. Nobody, I think, has ever said at Thanksgiving, you say, thank you, Lord, for all the misery in my life. We don't do that, do we? Thank you, Lord, because I broke my leg last week and now I can't drive and go to work. But thank you for that. We thank you for blessings. But why do you fear the God? Fear God because what you have. Job's question. And so God said, okay, stretch out your hand, and you touch everything he has. He said, well, that's what Satan said, if you'll let me do that, you'll let me take away everything that he has, he'll curse you. I'm going to prove to you how wrong you are. So the Lord said, okay, you can do everything but touch your body. Now that's going to happen. So Satan went out in the presence of the Lord. Why do you think Satan believes that? Or does he believe it? Or is he only hope? Does Satan really believe the only reason people serve God is because God's good to them? And so if God is not good to them, they won't serve God anymore. It's about God's in a sense. That I'm going to show, I'm going to prove to you how bad and how wrong you are.
John. There's also a sense of misery must come.
Okay. Misery must come.
When you think about the question you asked earlier about if we put our name where Job's name was, and then what God sees us and how we like, we're being seen by God, I think there's a sense of confidence that we gain from.
There's a sense that we're trying to reduce everybody to lowest common denominator. And good people tend to be dragged down by bad people. And no matter what it is, Satan probably doesn't believe it. However, why do you think God allows it to happen? God not love Job?
I think some of my biggest lessons. I know when you look back on the hard times, there was no money or the family situation was shaky or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then you realize, oh boy, that really wasn't as bad as it seemed like at the time. And you might even feel God's providential hand.
Sure.
You can see where it was inserted there. And like that.
Well, you know, I always, one thing that I noticed about my life is that I learned my best lesson in the worst way. Yeah. You know, that's kind of life, the way it is. And I listen to younger people who get all worried and anxious about various things. At my age, you want to say to them, don't worry about that. But they haven't lived it yet. You got to help them live it. So they can experience, so they'll know it's not that big a deal. But they have to get to the other side to do that. So God, let's put it this way, God lets Job get stronger. And I'm not sure we want to be that strong. Because of what's going to happen. Job is confident in Job. God is confident in Job's faith. He knows Job better than Job knows himself. Guess what? God knows you better than you do. He knows what you can stand, what you can't. And God limits what he will allow. He will allow everything to happen. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. He said, you'll be tempted, but you won't be overtaken beyond what you can bear. God doesn't eliminate temptation, but he limits where it goes. It's a big idea that we forget the moment. Now, let me ask you, does Job know any of what we just talked about was going on? Did he know about the conversation he had? Did he know what Satan was walking around? Did he know that God was confident? Did Job know any of this was happening? Do we? There's this concept in Ephesians chapter 6 where he talks about our struggles not against flesh and blood, but he said it's against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Things are happening we cannot see, know, or explain. And because of that, we have to live our life based upon what we know, and what you don't know is why you live by faith. So when you look at this thing, there's some things Job doesn't know. Job doesn't know about God's confidence in him. Would it help Job to know that God had said, have you considered my servant Job, how blameless and upright he is? Would it help us every once in a while if God would say, look, don't worry about it. I know who you are. Or, we don't know, he doesn't know about God's protection of him, the scope of which he's going to be dealt with, or God's purpose. When you don't know things, you have to believe something. Faith has to enter where knowledge ends. That's what Job is going to find out. There was a day. On this day, the best way I can explain it, it's like the old science fiction movie where someone were to be put in a room and suddenly the walls start to move in. The walls start to move in on Job. I like the way this is put. There's a messenger comes in, he's breathlessly said, there have been these raiders and they have taken away all your servants. And before he even finished the message, another messenger comes in and said, there was a lightning storm and it killed all your cattle. And before he could finish his message, then here comes another said, all your children are dead because of a tower fell on them. Job is surrounded on all sides by the difficulties of life. I know people who are surrounded on all sides by the difficulties of life. Life is doing well. Something came up. Something happened. Everything I'm unwrapping. His life was in pieces. Only Job knew what had happened, but he didn't know why it happened. That's an important question. So it says that Job has a response. Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell on the ground in worship. What do you think Job does with that? Okay.
He was broken.
He was broken. Okay. Why did he worship? Would you worship if you were in the circumstances of Job? Satan would have. It's really hard. You know, I've known enough people in my lifetime who they've had a death, and we've had a funeral that week, and the next week they say, I just can't come to church today. It's not because of God, it's because they're tired of people asking the same questions they can ask. One of the things, if you find somebody like that, don't ask them a bunch of questions. Just put your arms around them and love them. That's all it says. He worshiped God because he knew something about God. He says, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, the Lord take away, blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, in life, we come in without a stitch of clothing on. I have never known a baby being born in a onesie that grandma bought. Grandma always buys onesies. And I watch people be wheeled out of houses or hospitals with nothing more than a sheet over the top of them that is usually stained. We enter the world with nothing, we leave the world with nothing, and everything in between is only stuff. He says, the Lord has given, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God's blessings are a gift that we receive, not an entitlement. We have no right to the gifts of God, so if God withdraws his blessing, it is perfectly within his purview to do that. If you love the God who gave you blessings, you better be the God one who loves the God who takes them away. Because it's all the same. And that's what he has to do. He says, in all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. We're going to answer this question next week. But it's still next week. There are two dangers of suffering. The first is for saying God to do what Satan does. Tells you to do. And some people do that. They fall into his trap. The other is to blame God and give Satan satisfaction that God was wrong. Nothing tests your faith like calamity does. So fourth, that fourth day is when we leave. Why do you serve God? Can you, when your life is upside down? They're way the Christians, by the way. They're only great as long as I got what I want. They're not so great when I don't. But we have trials that we don't deserve, but are committed to go through them. You trust the enough to God to go through the trials. Big question. Do I have enough faith to go through trials? There's a plan we don't understand, but it's best. Can you accept the fact that maybe there's something good that's going to happen on the basis of what you're going through right now that you don't understand or you can't see? Finally, troubles. Do you recognize God's blessings or only see the curse of the moment? First, give glory to God, second, curse. Next week, we're going to go to Job 2. It's not the same, it's just worse again. So, thank you very much.